first subtopic under this is Citizenship Amendment Act and its associated issues, then NPR, NRC, Census, and comparative perspective of second, third, and fourth. There is NPR, NRC, and Census. In this, I've raised the question that is it necessary to practice test papers to clear prelims? In this video, we are continuing the topic which has started in the last video, that is citizenship, wherein I had discussed issues related to citizenship, the philosophical basis, constitutional aspects, and also issues related to NRC in Assam. And I also had made a mention that I am restricting to Assam in that particular video, and NRC Pan India will be brought up in the next video. So this is that particular video wherein we'll be discussing issues like CAA, NRC, etc. Hello everyone, welcome to Manifest IES. You're watching Current Jots, and this is Manjunath, Polity Faculty at Manifest. Current Jots is a current affairs initiative which we have started on April 1st, and as part of this program, we'll be covering all important current events which have transpired since June last year. We're not only providing free videos, but also free PDFs of these videos are available for download. As part of these, the program, we have already covered issues in polity like health, and one part of citizenship has already a video on which has already been released. In this video, we are continuing the topic which was started in the last video, that is citizenship, wherein I had discussed issues related to citizenship, the philosophical basis, constitutional aspects, and also issues related to NRC in Assam. And I also had made a mention that I am restricting to Assam in that particular video, and NRC Pan India will be brought up in the next video. So
subscribe now and press the bell icon. Never miss an update.
Before entering the topic, we'll look at the most important aspect of our unique aspect of this program, that is strategy talk, wherein I'll be raising certain questions which boggle the minds of aspirants while preparation, because it is not just studying, the method of study is also important. So in this, I've raised the question that is it necessary to practice test papers to clear prelims? I'll be answering this question at the end. If you also have any specific queries regarding your preparation or any issue for that matter, you can put your queries in the comment section. Also, you can write to me if you need a customized reply. My mail ID is manjunath.manifestias@gmail.com. Now, entering the topic, we'll list the subtopics for you first, then we'll look at each subtopic one by one. The first subtopic under this is Citizenship Amendment Act and its associated issues, then NPR, NRC, Census, and comparative perspective of second, third, and fourth. There is NPR, NRC, and Census. The first topic, that is CAA and associated issues. Now, CAA has created a furor in the society. Particularly, it has affected a specific minority group, due to which a large civil society movement has acquired momentum. Now, what exactly are the provisions of CAA we'll be looking into, and then certain criticisms against it which are relevant for prelims will be looked into, not all criticism, which are, because I am in these videos and specific to prelims, I'm restricting myself to prelims. So under this, the first, what are the provisions of the act? What is the aim of the act in general? The aim of the act is to give citizenship. It is amending the original act, which we had made a mention under the first video, that is Citizenship Act 1955. So this is the latest amendment. It was initiated in 2006 and passed recently in 2019. So under this, what does it seek to do? It seeks to give citizenship to certain groups of people. Now, who are those groups, and who do they belong to, or where do they belong to? That we'll look into. The first thing is the act aims to give citizenship to illegal migrants. And as part of my earlier video, I have defined who is an illegal migrant or a foreigner, wherein I have said that illegal migrant has come to India and has migrated to India by violating the rules or provisions of two specific acts. One is the Foreigners Act 1946 and the second is the Passport Entry into India Act 1920, both of which I had mentioned. So someone who is doesn't have a passport or is overstaying in India is considered an illegal migrant. Now, what about this illegal migrant? What does the bill say? It says that illegal migrants from three specific countries, that is Afghanistan, Bangladesh, and Pakistan, belonging to certain specific groups, that is Hindus, Sikhs, Buddhists, Jains, Parsis, Christians. These are the minorities in that country. It is the non-Muslim population in those countries, these will be getting citizenship. So this, the reasoning given behind this move is that there is a need to protect minorities against religious persecution. Though the act doesn't very specifically mention, the government has time and again said it in the parliament. How does it seek to give citizenship? It's, so I told you, a foreigner can get citizenship through naturalization. A person of Indian origin can get it through the registration process. Both these terms I have made a mention of. So what is naturalization process? You become a naturalized citizen if you are staying in India for at least 11 years. Now this provision has been relaxed. How has it been relaxed? By reducing the number of years. The requirement of 11 years is now reduced to 6 years. So if someone is an illegal migrant belonging to those particular communities from those three countries, from any of those three countries, and staying in India for 6 years, they are eligible for citizenship. Now, other than this, it also talks about an important provision called OCA, slightly the neglected part because the contentious issues have been more highlighted. It also says that OCI, that is Overseas Citizenship of India, which I made a mention of in my last video, that this scheme was brought in 2004. So these people are those who have this card, their citizenship can be taken away in certain cases if they violate a law, is what it is said. So these are the major provisions. Now, as far as its applicability, where all does it apply? It applies to almost all territories of India except a few territories. Which are those territories? It is not applicable to 6 scheduled areas. Now, what are 6 scheduled areas? These are tribal areas. And under this, tribal areas are in total 10 such tribal areas exist. They are distributed across or spread across 4 states, Meghalaya, Tripura, Mizoram, Assam. So the act will not apply to these areas because their local culture has to be protected from any external influence or foreigners or outsiders, and hence this is not applicable to these regions. So it is not all states, it is only those tribal areas of these particular states. Other than that, it does not apply to states where inner line permit exists. Now, what is inner line permit system? That we'll be looking into. So these are the exceptions under the act. Now, what is inner line permit? It's a very important concept which can be asked in prelims. Inner line permit system is a system wherein it was initiated to protect the local people from any kind of foreign intrusion. Now, this system is an outcome of British Indian policies. There was an act which was passed called Eastern Frontier Regulation 1873 Act. Now, what was this act? What kind of policy was it? Britain followed a policy towards tribals called the isolationist policy. When it tried to rule over tribals, there was a huge backlash and rebellions occurred. As a result of which, British adopted the policy of isolationism, that is isolating the tribals from the mainland. And as part of this, it passed this act, and under this, there was a system devised, that is inner line permit system. So what does inner line permit system as of today mean? It is a permit so if you have to visit these areas, that is, what are the areas I'll be mentioning them and making it. So if you have to visit these areas, you require a permit. So inner line permit prohibits citizens of India from visiting these areas without a permit. So if you have to visit, you have to get a permit. So this entire system is managed by Ministry of Home Affairs, and the permit cards are also given by at the local level. The system is managed by Home Affairs. The permit cards are given by the state government, or at the level of district magistrates also it works. So which are the areas which come under the isolationist model of the inner line permit system? There are three states. Entire state of Nagaland, except one place, the commercial hub Dimapur, except that, the entire state of Nagaland is under inner line permit system. Other than that, Arunachal Pradesh, then there is Mizoram. Manipur was not as not part of it. It was recently added, so it has been an inner line permit system is now applicable to Manipur also from January 1st, 2020. So in total, there are four states. With Nagaland, there is one exception, that is Dimapur is not under it. So as part of this, what is the system meant for? This system is meant for protecting local culture, and also CAA not being applied to these areas makes or keeps the system intact. Next is, so related to these terms, there are some other terms which you should be knowing, which might be asked in prelims, though not directly related to CAA. There is one more system called restricted area permit. Restricted area permit system is for the foreigners. It is the system which exists for citizens of India is ILP, but for our foreigners it is called RAP. So this is applicable to the most northeastern areas, and also parts of Sikkim and Andaman and Nicobar Islands come under it. And more importantly, remember this thing, it does not come under Bengal Eastern Frontier Regulation. It comes under Foreigners Order 1963, Restricted Areas. This comes under the Foreigners Act 1946. There is one more similar concept called protected area permits, and this protected area permits applies to certain states like Himachal, Ladakh, Sikkim, etc. Also, you have to remember that protected area permit is again for foreigners only. So foreigners are not allowed to visit these places. Only certain tourist visas are given to certain or to citizens of certain countries. So who are allowed? Bangladeshi citizens, Pakistani and Chinese and Myanmar citizens are allowed in these areas, and the restrictions are also very strict here. Even a person from these protected areas, if he marries a non-Indian, he cannot settle permanently in these areas. So all this system, if you look into it, is a system of protecting cultural aspects. So this is somewhere related to CA, but not completely. Only ILP is related to CA. So that is why I've dealt this along with CA only. Coming to the next topic, it is registration of indigenous inhabitants of Nagaland. Now this was an initiative which was by the Nagaland state government, wherein this was inspired from the NRC of Assam. Just like NRC of Assam was to protect the local people, this was also a move to protect the local people from outsiders. So this aimed to create a registry of indigenous inhabitants of Nagaland to be protected from outsiders. Now, as part of this, the indigenous inhabitants will be given a number, indigenous inhabitant certificate, and anyone who wants to visit from outside, they should get a permit that comes under the inner line permit system. I also mentioned that Dimapur does not come under it. So by bringing this system, it is somewhere including Dimapur also as part of the protected areas under it. So this is considered as a follow-up, or this is considered to be inspired from NRC of Assam. Now when you look at all the areas wherein it is CA is applicable or not applicable, Assam is the most affected, because only a part of Assam, that is the tribal area of Assam, it is not applicable there. Rest of Assam CA is applicable. So in this case, it has become a huge problem for Assam state, and that is why the civil society movement and also the protest which kick-started, it was a massive movement which started in Assam. Now, what was the issue with Assam that we will look into? Because Assam or CA goes against the spirit of Assam Accord. In my last lecture, I had discussed what is Assam Accord. Assam Accord was signed in 1985, wherein it was said that NRC will be conducted in Assam. And as a result, NRC was also done. So I discussed the outcome of NRC. What was the outcome of NRC? 19 lakh people were considered doubtful that So there was a probability of these people being declared as foreigners. So this was in some way as a kind of solution to the locals of Assam who had grievances against the foreigners or the outsiders taking their local job opportunities. Now with the coming of CAA, it comes in clash with Assam Act. The deadline or the year of which is considered as a deadline was 1971 in Assam Accord. But in this in CAA, the deadline of the year is December 31st, 2014. So that deadline, I think I did not make a mention in CAA. That is the deadline. That is those people who have come prior to this date will be given citizens. Now, what exactly de facto, what is the outcome of this? Those 19 lakh people, out of those 19 lakh people, whoever belongs to those communities, that is the communities which I have listed out, the non-Muslim communities, they will be getting citizenship. In a sense, it is completely overruling Assam Accord. It is completely making Assam Accord defunct. Hence, it is an assault on federalism. Now, it is in this context only I'll be discussing certain problems of CAA. The first thing is it is violating the idea of federalism, idea of bargaining federalism. The federal principles of Assam Accord are being affected. That is one thing. Second thing is it is violating Article 14 because Article 14 talks about equality, that is equality for everybody. The word person is used, not citizen. So everybody has to be, or everyone has to be treated equally. It also violates Articles 25 to 28, wherein it talks about right to religion. So Article 14 and Article 25 to 28, I'll be discussing separately in my later videos. Now, what is the principle which is being violated? What is the principle which is being violated in 25 and 28? When I do a separate video on religion, I'll be bringing up that issue. Other than that, CAA also violate certain international conventions like the convention on status related to refugees 1951, which does not make a mention of religion at all. Religious persecution is not an idea which is, I mean, it is, you cannot have an exclusion. I mean, though it mentions about persecution on the basis of religion, etc., you cannot cherry pick only religion and religious minorities and give them protection. It is, you cannot have a selective approach under that particular convention. So it is violative of that as well. And it is, and as part of this, many states also have challenged this particular act, particularly Kerala and recently Rajasthan has also filed a case against this particular act under Article 131. So hence 131 becomes important, Article 14 becomes important. Under Article 14, the idea of reasonable classification. What is reasonable classification? That we'll do in Article 15 and women when I'll be bringing up that particular topic in my next, in my upcoming videos. And it is also violating 25 to 28. That also becomes important. And the convention related to refugees, when I do international relations videos, there I'll be picking it up. So these are the problems with CAA. Particularly the biggest problem is Assam Accord. Next, with respect to the idea of federalism, I had raised one issue, that is certain states have challenged this, particularly Kerala and Rajasthan, under Article 131 and 258. What does 131 relate to? 131 talks about original jurisdiction of Supreme Court, wherein if there is a conflict between the center and the state, it is the Supreme Court which has the authority to solve this or resolve these disputes or adjudicate on these disputes. And it is original in nature, that is, you can directly knock the doors of the Supreme Court. Also, you have to remember that it is exclusive as well. When you say it is exclusive, no other court in the country has the authority to solve or adjudicate on federal disputes. So it is under this Kerala has challenged that this is a kind of dispute that has cropped up because it violates certain constitutional provisions. The act violates certain constitutional provisions and they do not want to implement it because it will be violating the spirit of the constitution. And when Kerala was asked as to where does it get the authority from to challenge central laws, because the constitution does not make a mention of it anywhere, as to, because it makes it mandatory for the state to implement laws, particularly under 258, and also when you say 258, particularly is talked about mutual delegation of functions, wherein the state delegates certain functions from the center to the state and state to the center. So this make, under this, Kerala says that, it puts its position saying that under this, when functions are being given to the state, there are certain powers and authority being given to the state as well. It is under this certain rights of the state crop up, and through these rights we are challenged in this particular act. But legally, I think the position is untenable, but in terms of the spirit of protecting constitution, their ideas stand valid. Moving to the next aspect, that is NPR. Why did the issue of NPR come up in the first place? That we'll look into. When CAA was being passed, there was a lot of debate and also a heated debate in parliament regarding the issue of NRC. So many criticized CAA as a background for NRC. So when CAA happens, what will happen is once pan-India NRC occurs, therein certain people who are considered as doubtful citizens, if there is a group of people belonging to the non-minority group, non-Muslim group, if they are recognized as doubtful categories under NRC, and if there is one group, that is the Muslim group, which is recognized as a doubtful category under CAA, the possibility of getting citizenship for the non-Muslim categories is more. I mean, it is established. I mean, it's easier. Or rather, it is, they can confidently say that they can get citizenship, but these people will not be given the equal opportunity. So it is in this context that it was rejected, or many people rejected, saying that CAA cannot be passed and also NRC should not happen. So when NRC was challenged, that is when government retracted its statement, and then it said that instead of NRC, it is going to bring NPR. Now politics aside, it becomes important for us to know the constitutional and the legal aspects behind NRC, NPR, and also what is census and how it is linked to NPR. Now, when you say NPR, what does it mean? NPR means it is a database of usual residents. Now, who are residents? Residents are those people who have been residing in India for the past 6 months or more, and who intend to reside for next 6 months or more. So this will be a list of these people. Now, where does the government get the authority to conduct NPR? It is given in Citizenship Act 1955. Under this, there have been rules framed. If you remember in my last lecture, I had said that certain rules also govern Citizenship Act, that is citizenship in India, that is Citizenship Rules 2003 are very important. Under this, NPR is made a mention. So what does it say? NPR will be conducted. It will be the nodal authority for NPR will be the Registrar General and Census Commissioner, which is an office under Ministry of Home Affairs. And how exactly it will be implemented? It will be implemented through the local registrar. He is empowered to, while conducting NPR, is empowered to mark against the individual, that is certain appropriate remarks are made in case the person is considered a doubtful citizen. So thus NPR becomes a base for NRC. It is clearly written under citizenship rules that NPR data will be used for NRC, because while NPR is being conducted, the doubtful categories are also listed. So in a sense, NPR forms the basis for NRC as well. Now, how it is when was it conducted first, and when was it updated, etc. NPR was first created in 2010 and it was updated in 2015, and remember that it was not updated in Assam and Meghalaya in 2015 and 16. Now it is being done notification for this that it will be done in April 1, 2020. It will start on April 1st, 2020, but it could not happen. It was deferred due to COVID. So NPR is now being done with census. Now we'll consider the link between NPR and NRC. Now NRC was first done for the first time in 1951. After that, no NRC has been done. NPR has been done thrice. NRC is basically a catalog of citizens. NPR is a catalog of residents. And if you look at the parameters parameters on which information is collected, there were in 2015 there were 15 2010 there were 15 parameters, and as of 2020 pro forma, if you see, there are 21 parameters. 6 more parameters have been added. I have included the slides of the pro forma, which new six new categories have been added. Just go through them, because since it's a contentious issue, minute questions are possible. Now, what are the challenges to NPR? NPR has been rejected by many states because it is inextricably linked to NRC. So, and NRC has been in a way linked to CAA. So since this has created a chain of ruckus, many people or many states have said or have put NPR on a hold. Now, how has the government tried to address the issue? The first thing it has said is, while conducting NPR, it has softened on the issue of NPR. What are the changes it has made? First thing it has said that it will not be, conducting NRC. It has not given a very clear statement or an equivocal statement on that, wherein it has neither said yes, it will be conducting, nor it has not even said it will not be conducting. It has just said no decision has been taken regarding NRC. Now, as far as NPR, what it says is, under NPR, there is no requirement for people to show documents. And also it says that NPR will not be the basis for citizenship, because the Home Minister in the Parliament has very clearly made a statement that against NPR, the doubtful category will not be included. Now, what you have to remember also is, NPR is an identity-based catalog. It is different from census. Census is a social catalog. It's a population. It brings you figures related to the population dynamics. So more of the differences we'll look into. Now, what has the government, so I told you that is the first thing. Second thing is, it has also given certain independence to people, saying that certain information related to their parents, etc., are voluntary in nature. They can deny the information as well. So this way it has softened its stand regarding NPR. Other than that, it has now closely linked NPR. So NRC could not happen. Now what they have done is, the government has linked NPR slowly with census, or slightly with census. How it has done? It has said that when NPR is not being used for citizenship, then what it will be used for? Government or the ministry has said that NPR will be used for welfare issues. The details will be collected and it will be probably linked with Aadhaar, and this way it will be easier to target for welfare schemes, is what the idea message given by the ministry. Now, through this, what has happened is, NPR has closely got linked with census, because census is the basis for collection of data for welfare related to general welfare schemes and also related to health statistics, etc. and all. So this way, NPR and census have got linked. Now we'll move to the idea of what is census, and finally we'll make a comparative perspective of NPR and NRC and census. Now, a pro forma of NPR I have attached, I have included it, you can just look into. There are 21 categories, earlier there were 15 in 2010. Now, what is census? Census is it's a collection of data which is conducted generally in two phases. It is conducted, first phase is the house listing, and the second is the population enumeration. Now, where does the government get the authority from? The government gets the authority from Census Act 1948, which was amended in 1994. The nodal ministry for census is Ministry of Home Affairs. And also remember, it is not just census, NPR, NRC, everything is conducted by the Ministry of Home Affairs, and under it there is a specific office called the Registrar General and Census Commissioner. We'll be looking at this office in detail at the last. Now, this is the act, the nodal act for census. Under this, what are the unique features of the decennial census of 2021? It will be done in two phases, is what I said. The first phase, population enumeration, was to start on April 1st, 2020. That now it has been deferred. And population enumeration will be starting from 2021. All states are included under it, except three, Jammu, Kashmir, Himachal and Uttarakhand. And also, it has said that along with this, NPR will also be conducted. Now, census of 2021 is being done in 18 languages out of the 22 scheduled languages listed under the 8th schedule of constitution. Just for your comparative perspective, in 2011 it was done only in 16 languages. So the number of languages in which it is being done has now been enlarged or increased. Now, it will also introduce a code directory to streamline the process. Now what and also it is there is a new feature that it is done through you can register or you can register yourself through the online model. There is a specific app which has been developed. Now this is the first time the data is will be now available digitally also, and this is the first time in almost 140 years that you have the entire data is now being digitized. So this makes the process faster, because census conduction or conducting census takes a lot many years, because 2011 data is still being collected and aggregated. But this process makes it faster. And also, instead of the option of other, now there is a third gender category. Third gender category was, the option of other was there in 2011 also. As part of this, around 5 lakh people were there under the other category. Now other is now being replaced with third gender. This is in line with the judgment given by the Supreme Court. In Supreme Court, in a particular case called Nalsa versus Union of India 2014. Under this case, transgender was recognized as a third gender. It was also said that a third gender column has to be introduced as part of the official documents, and it is in line with that. And also have to remember that there are 34 questions in the census pro forma, 21 questions with respect to NPR. Clearly remember these details. These minute questions are highly possible. Next important feature is, which I'm already mentioned, 140 year in all 140 years, this is the first time it is being done. So self enumeration you can do through the mobile app. Now once you do it through the mobile app, the physical enumeration will also happen. Reference number they'll arrive and they'll collect the data, and all these activities will be real time monitored through a portal called Census Monitoring and Management System. So these are the unique features of census. Now, as part of census, you should be knowing two important terms, civil registration system and sample registration system. I slightly made a mention of this when I was discussing WHO under COVID, wherein I said that WHO brings civil statistics. So therein I had said that what is civil statistics? It is similar to that. In India, civil registration system means it is the data related to the births and deaths. Whereas sample registration system means health statistics like birth rate, death rate, mortality rate, mortality rate or death rate, maternal mortality ratio and fertility rate, etc. and all. So civil registration system is data related to births and deaths only. Sample registration system relates to health statistics like mortality rate, maternal mortality ratio, etc. And this forms the basis for all your welfare schemes and other affirmative actions of the government. Now, census, I told you, is done under the Ministry of Home Affairs, and there is a specific office called Office of Registrar General. And when you look at in this, I'm giving you certain more specific details related to sample registration system. The system began in India in 1964-65 on a pilot basis, and full scale it was done in 69-70. And the SRS system has dual records at the field level and at the aggregation level. Now, very specifically, some historical details you should be knowing regarding census. Now, when you look at census as a system, when was the first census conducted, what is the historical aspects that we'll look into. Before that, some ideas regarding caste census. In caste census, there was a notification given by the Ministry of Home Affairs. It said that OBC data will also be collected as part of census, because till date under census only SCST enumeration is done, not OBC. Later on, Registrar General of India, he disagreed, saying that it will be only SCST, it will not be OBC data, because caste data is slightly spurious and it will affect the credibility of the results. And also you have caste data, a separate census has already been done, that is in 2011, called the socio-economic caste census, and there was no requirement is what was the reasoning given. Now specific ideas related to historical aspects related to census, I told, is the first, the last caste-based census in India was in 1931. As part of this, some ideas I'm giving. Caste census in India was started by the British. Caste census, though caste system existed, official enumeration of caste started under British, and that is when caste becomes part of the legal system, and it becomes highly solidified, highly fossilized as well, because once you get a certificate, officially it becomes difficult to change. The fluidity which existed earlier starts, it is lost once caste census is conducted by the British. And the first synchronous census in India was done in 1818. So these are the historical aspects you need to know regarding census. Now, as part of the slides, I've also attached what are the 34 parameters. Just look at them and have a comparative perspective, or compare it with the pro forma of NPR also, so that you get a fair idea of what are the differences between the two. Now, as far as thematic differences among the three, what are the thematic differences? Census is governed by a separate act, Census Act. And you have to know that census is not an identification data. Your identity is not determined by your census. That is, you cannot say you are enumerated as part of census, then that is why you are this particular person. It is basically a population or a demographic data. So it's a group phenomenon, it's a social aspect. So as part of that, you have house listing, and also the second is population enumeration. So the act is different, the basis for its collection of data is also different. Now, what is NRC? NRC is a catalog of citizens wherein it identifies citizens and foreigners, and it is identity based. Now, the only link which existed between census and NRC was after the first census. The first NRC was out of the census data. That was the only link which it had. After that, you don't see any specific links. Now, what is NPR? And also, you have to remember, NRC is governed by Citizenship Act 1955. And NPR is also governed by Citizenship Act 1955. And NPR is also identity based. And it has 21 parameters in the recent one. And NPR, when it is identity based, so it was inextricably linked to NRC under Citizenship Act 1955 and Citizenship Rules 2003. Recently, with the policies of the government, there has been no official legal or statutory change which has been made. With the official change in the policies, NPR has now been linked with census, because NPR data, which the government, the government has said, is being used for welfare-based schemes. It is not being used to identify citizens. So, now, taking the government to the face value, it seems that NPR is now being linked with census, though the acts governing both are completely different. So these are the ideas you need to know very clearly, because any kind of questions which are very particular in nature might confuse you. So legal basis, and also the ideological aspects, and also the governance aspects behind these things should be known very clearly. With this, I've completed almost all the ideas. Now, almost all the ideas related to CAA and also citizenship. Now, as part of this, what you have to know is, be it citizenship, be it CAA, and then the Act, or NPR, NRC, or census, the nodal ministry for this is Ministry of Home Affairs, and the nodal office for this is Registrar General and Census Commissioner of India. So what is this office that we look into? This office was founded in 1961, and it functions under Ministry of Home Affairs. It brings out two important surveys that which you have to remember very clearly. What is one is population survey, which we popularly known as Census of India. It also brings linguistic survey of India, wherein the languages which are endangered, the languages which need support, etc., and all those are brought under the Linguistic Survey of India. Now, we'll look at what is Home Ministry and what are the different departments and how does it function. And also, one more point is, the position of Registrar is usually held by a civil servant at the level of the rank of Joint Secretary. Now, moving to the last aspect, Nodal Ministry for this entire talk, because Ministry of Home Affairs, it has 6 department under it. I am doing this taking the cue from the trend. The trend has been lately focusing on questions related to administration, and I've made a detailed analysis of this particular trend in my polity strategy video. You can visit the channel and look at the kinds of questions which are asked in polity. So a question on Department of Border Management has also been asked, not recently, but a few years back. So also in your main syllabus, it has been very clearly mentioned, the ministries and their organization. So technically, there is no difference between prelims and main syllabus these days, because most of the questions or most of the issues which are there in mains are being asked in prelims, like agriculture. There are international issues, etc., and are being lately focused on, and administrative governance issues are also being focused on. So as part of this, I mean, considering this, I'm dealing with almost all the ministries, because I've done Ministry of Health also when I did health is an issue. So under this, there are four departments: Department of Border Management, Department of Internal Security, Department of Jammu and Kashmir Affairs, Department of Home and Official Language, and Department of States. Now, Department of Jammu and Kashmir Affairs, etc., this particular department I'll be picking up when I pick up the issue of federalism. Just generally remember the idea of departments, internal security separately, in internal security as a department I'll be bringing up. Department of States, remember its two functions. It deals with the center state functions. Particularly, if you see, this is this has been bequeathed from history. If you look at Department of States, why does it come under Ministry of Home Affairs? Because under Vallabhbhai Patel, the states were managed by Vallabhbhai Patel. The reorganization of states, accession of states, etc., was done by Ministry of Home Affairs, and unity and integrity as an idea is central to this ministry, and that is why Department of States come under this. And also, as part of this, the pensions related to freedom fighters, etc., and also comes under this department only, Department of States. So two functions: center state relations, and second is the pensions related to freedom fighters is determined by Department of States. So with this, I have completed all the topics, all the subtopics under citizenship. Two videos, I think this would suffice completely for citizenship, all the issues which have been making waves in citizenship. Moving to the penultimate component of this topic, of this video, that is the questions related to them. As part of this, I have asked three questions. The first question is related to census. The second question is again related to census, NPR, NRC, comparative perspective. And the third one is related to the CAA. Now, coming to the final part, do answer these questions in the comment section, because we are assessing as to how much of the video you are getting, and also it helps us improve in terms of our outcomes as well. Also, more importantly, based on your responses, we are thinking of giving a full-fledged question paper on all the current topics after finishing or completing a sizable chunk. So finally, coming to the final aspect, that is the issue or the strategy talk. In the strategy talk, what is the issue which I have raised? The issue which I have raised is related to the solving of test papers. Is it mandatory to solve test papers to clear prelims, etc.? So I wouldn't say it is mandatory. I mean, it's not like if you do not solve test papers, you won't be clearing, but solving question papers will improve your chances of clearing the exam. Now, how does solving test papers work? First, understand the logic behind why do you solve certain questions. So when you study a particular topic, you're studying it as a chain. So suppose you're studying fundamental rights, you're studying for Article 14, 15, 16. You remember it as a chain memory. This particularly is very pertinent in case of history. When you read history, you study it in the form of chronology, one after the other. So age of Buddha, then Maurya, Gupta, etc. and all. In this way, when you're studying, your memory is linked with the things which are there prior to it and after it. So it is not very discrete. But the questions which are asked in prelims, they are independent questions. They are discretely asked. They are discrete units. So suddenly they'll ask you a question on Maurya, which is not, and the question prior to it is not necessarily linked to Gupta or anything else which is closely associated with. So this way, what you are studying and what is being asked in exam, the memory structure is slightly different. So as a result, solving questions becomes important to get attuned to that kind of a discrete memory, a discrete unit memory. So solving questions is very, very helpful because it acts as a revision. It will help you remember different facts independently as a unit. And more importantly, it will also help you assess as to whatever you have read, whether that is you are able to remember them, and whatever you have been reading, whether you're reading the right things or not. So suppose you read a particular topic and solve UPSC questions and you're not able to solve those questions, it shows that your style of studying or your focus on the specific issues in that particular topic has been incorrect, because UPSC demand has been something else and you have been reading something else. So these are the important objectives of doing a test paper. Now remember certain things while doing test papers. First thing is, do not overdo test series. And when I say overdo, what do I understand by this? Do not, like, there are so many institutions, there are so many test series. Don't get confused by taking multiple number of test series. I think it would not be, it would suffice for you to do one or two test series at max, along with UPSC papers. Now, why UPSC papers are very, very important? Because test papers relate of institutions are slightly different. I wouldn't categorize it as less standards or higher standards. They're slightly different from UPSC, however hard we try. So that way you have to, because you, when you do only the institution papers, you will be in the mode of the institution. So what you have to do is, just prior to the exam, stop all institution papers. Completely focus on UPSC papers. Last 10 papers, I have given a demarcating year. 2008 or 9 was the demarcating year when the change occurred and which is still continuing. So those papers you can solve, so to be in the UPSC mode. Also, there is a trick to solve there is a method to solve test papers as well. When you solve test papers, do not just go for the answers, read the solutions in details. Collect the entire information related to that particular topic in the question, and also collect the information of all the four options. It is not important to find the right answer for that question. It is important to know the logic behind all the four options, because it is not always possible that that question is going to come. Higher chances are that it does not come, because UPSC has always been a pioneer in terms of bringing new questions. So rely on test papers, but do not overdo it, and do not exclusively rely on them. Do UPSC papers as well. That's all for today in this particular video. Thank you. Have a great day.